Beautifully crafted objects made with care and great precision. But they haven't been sculpted, or cast, or machine pressed. A different process has been employed. This is 3D printing. At a design studio in London's Shoreditch, they can not only conceive products, they can make them, thanks to a technology that is falling in price and so becoming more accessible. It allows you to make just about anything. I'm being scanned, with software then building a precise template of my face. That will then be used to print out a 3D me. So I've been scanned. What's next in the process?
So we take that data and then we prepare it into a 3D print-ready file, and we take it over here to this machine. Which,
you don't send it off to a factory somewhere?
No, right here. It's a very office-friendly machine. Just sits in the corner, sort of humming away. And this will print your file layer by layer. And this particular machine prints in a powder-based material. It's a whole new way of producing particular customised objects, individual objects that are individual to the user. I think that's one fantastic things about 3D printing, and also the ability to have it in your hand within hours rather than waiting for it to be shipped around the world.
Let's have a look. There I am, complete with chain. Now, it would have been possible to make a mini-me like this many years ago, but it would have been much more expensive and time-consuming. What 3D printing has begun to do is to take manufacturing out of the factory and into a small design studio like this. But there are some who believe it can go much further, heralding a whole new industrial revolution. So, what is 3D printing? It starts with a digital design or scan that's then fed into the printer. The process is also called additive manufacturing because it involves building up objects layer by layer rather than pressing them out. Right now, a limited range of materials can be used, mainly plastics and resins, but the first metal printers are now emerging. However, it's a big fall in prices that's driving take-up. In 2002, even a budget 3D printer might have cost £20,000. Today, you can get a desktop device for under £1,000. And the range of objects that the technology can deliver keeps expanding. In the medical world, it's being used in dental work, and this is a replacement jawbone built out of titanium powder. The fashion industry is experimenting. Here's a 3D printed bikini. This flute came out of a printer, though it needs some fine tuning. And at Loughborough University, they're even printing concrete and exploring how the construction industry might be transformed. But for some, this is a revolution that starts at home.
The great drive for me is to improve the quality of home 3D printing.
In his living room in southeast London, Paul Candler devotes much of his time to his passion for 3D printing. He's proud that he's adapted his machine to print in layers of just 20 microns. That's a 50th of a millimetre thick.
I think it will become a commonplace item. If you look back, it wasn't that long ago that people thought that you wouldn't have a computer in every single home. And you certainly wouldn't have a nice colour printer in every home. And now, every home has at least one printer. And when you get to the stage where you literally just have to load a file, press a button, that will be the stage where they will become mainstream.
Paul is part of an online movement which uploads and shares designs for other 3D printer hobbyists to download. But therein lies a looming problem. Any revolutionary new technology provides both opportunities and threats. Just ask the music industry. As 3D printing becomes more commonplace, the value of the digital designs fed into the printers should rise, but so will the threat of piracy. Once your designs have escaped onto the internet, there's nothing to stop anyone anywhere from printing out your products without your permission. So one industry should benefit from the rise of 3D printing, and that's the patent lawyers.
This is actually a 3D print, so the next stage beyond this is to create a mould.
These, for instance, are rare artefacts from Cambridge's Fitzwilliam Museum, or rather replicas, 3D printed for the museum shop. Ownership of the scans which produced these objects could be very valuable. But one leading designer thinks the new technology could also help outwit the copiers.
The time to marketplace will be much quicker, and that's crucial in the world of intellectual property, where you need to get out there quickly and take advantage of your invention before someone copies it.
At the Royal College of Art's new Dyson building, some graduates are being helped to turn student ideas into real products. 3D printing is already an essential part of making prototypes. Soon it could transform how products are manufactured.
You can be independent. You don't need tool makers, you don't need moulders, you don't need casters, you don't need foundries. You can do it all yourself with a relatively simple, I hope, machine. So you can make things all over the place. You could make them very locally to each country that you're selling in, so you get rid of freight costs and import duties and all those sort of things. So I think eventually it will completely transform the way products are made.
It will reproduce every single layer.
From the hobbyist experimenting at home to industrial designers with ever more sophisticated techniques, 3D printing appears to be advancing on all fronts. Just like virtual reality in the 1990s, it's the subject of huge, perhaps inflated, expectations. But its exponents believe this is a revolution that will deliver on its promises.